You're watching the free version of Silhouette Essentials. For projects and footage, head to BorisFX.com for the premium download.
Next, let's talk about the roto for the man walking through the shot, which will be a brief demo as we are more focused on the hard surface roto here. I'm going to disable the visibility for the interior building and just collapse that. I'll just zoom in a little bit. Initially, I tried tracking the legs and part of the torso, but it's such a dark suit that the trackers were not grabbing onto anything. And I tried the technique of just making a shape around the edge of the fabric and the background, but that didn't work either. So I had to come up with a different solution. In the end, I was able to track the torso to remove some of the movement out of the walking, and then I rotoed in that stabilized view, which made it a bit easier. And I'll just expand my torso here, and we'll go down to the area where the torso was tracked, and I'm going to turn on the tracking shape. But first, let's just make sure that we have the torso, all the parent layer, turned on. And now you can see that here's my tracking shape, and I will go up to the stabilize icon here and go down to roto final and torso all, torso tracked. And now you can see the torso is kind of staying in the middle of the viewer. It's just taking the movement of the person walking out of the equation. So that makes it a bit easier, like I said. We'll just stop this here. So it's a lot of manual roto, you can see, with all these keyframes. And that's really not unexpected. It's just sometimes tracking assist really won't be the full solution. But I was able to roto the head and the hair with tracking assist. And we'll just zoom in here. I'm going to collapse some layers and we'll turn on the head. And here I'll enable my tracking shapes, which were green. And let me just turn on the head itself, turn off the head. So the green is my tracking shape. And there was just a few keyframes that were needed. It's mostly static hair, but at the same time, it's nice to be able to track something and not have to worry about doing a lot of manual roto for hair. Okay, and then I'll just show the man roto in entirety. I'm going to turn off the tracking shapes here. I'm going to go out of the stabilized view to none and make sure all of my shapes are turned on. Can just turn off that one tracking shape at the bottom. And zoom out. So besides having all these organized layers of shapes and trackers and nested layers, you can also have a lot of options for colors. And so instead of using all the same color shape for all the splines, I broke them up into different groups. And it was kind of a nice way to keep things organized in my mind, what parts that they're done, instead of using the multicolored option. So it's just a personal preference, and there's just so many options. The last thing I want to touch on here for this walking man is motion blur. We haven't talked about that much in this course, so we're going to touch on that briefly here. So here our subject has some motion blur. You can see it in this shoe area here. So if he goes forward, you can see it. I'll just disable the overlay for a moment. And if you have motion blur in your shot, you want to make sure that you either turn it on live or that it's enabled when you render out your mats so that the motion blur is part of your render. So in order to have motion blur, you have to do two things first. You have to find your layer here and you have to enable motion blur in the object list. So here's my shape. I'm going to press this icon here and now the motion blur is enabled. And you also need to go to the node parameters. Click on the node tab here and enable motion blur. Right now it is set to the default settings. And we'll just pull this down here. So if I click A, you can see that, and let me just disable the overlays here, that we have some motion blur. I'll click A again, and you can see the alpha channel. It's nice and soft. We're looking at the viewer through the output. But you can see here that there's no motion blur on this first frame, and that's a problem. In order to get motion blur, you have to add a frame at the head, except that our sequence doesn't have any more frames at the head. If I go to the list view with icon, you can see here our very first frame is 1703945, and that is what is listed here in the time bar. So you're thinking we probably can't add a frame at the head, but in Silhouette you can add a temporary frame at the head. And what you can do is you can just click this little down arrow, and that's going to give you a frame right there. So let's just make sure we're selected on our layer. You can see it here in the timeline, and now you can see we have an extra frame. So if I go back to the first frame that we just made, I'm going to go back to our RGBA, enable our overlays. I'm going to just move this shape where I think it needs to go. So I'm looking at this movement here as it goes forward. It's just sort of the foot's going down. If I'm going back, it's just going to maybe the next frame, it would be a little bit up and to the left. So I'm going to select my shape, press T, and I'm just going to imagine where the next frame might be. And then now if I click A, you can see the overlays. We now have motion blur. I'll just turn this off. So now our first frame, that is our temporary frame right here, 1703944, and the first frame of our sequence is 1703945, and you can see that now has motion blur. And this frame won't be rendered. So now that we're done making our shape, we can actually go back and make our timeline to the correct length. And that's how you can create motion blur at the head of a shot and the same at the tail. And if your sequence actually starts at zero, you can add in a negative frame number as well. It's really handy.